Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Today we're going to be in chapter 20, which is going to pick up in the last few verses of chapter 19, where it says that Jesus was teaching daily in the temple. Now, this is going to be very ironic because the religious leaders are trying to arrest him, find some charge to remove him. And yet, Jesus is teaching in the temple. And now in chapter 20, we're going to get an idea of what these teaching sessions were like. The Sanhedrin is going to ask a question. The Pharisees are going to ask a question. The Sadducees are going to ask a question. And so all the groups are going to kind of be circling Jesus, you know, to try to catch him. Let's listen. One day while he was teaching in the temple and preaching the good news, euangelion, and the gospel ought to be good news, friends, the high priest, the scribes, together with the elders. Now, this is the official designation for the Sanhedrin. It was the ruling court, the supreme court of the Jews, made up of 70 members in Jerusalem. Under Rome, it had limited rights, especially in the area of religious matters. They say it, they couldn't kill anybody, but obviously they killed Stephen, so they had, something's up. Took their stand against him and said to him, "Tell us what sort of authority you have for doing as you do, or who is it that gave you such authority?" Now, this is the key question about all matters of faith. What is the authority of God himself? What is the authority of the Bible? What is the authority of Jesus? Well, once you come to conclusion on those matters, then the rest will be relatively easy. So this was the central question. Where do you get off doing what you're doing? Jesus is going to answer them. But he's going to answer them by a counter question. Now, at first it seems irrelevant when you just read it once. And he answered them, "I will ask you a question too. Tell me, was John's baptism from heaven or men?" Now, why would Jesus talk about John's baptism in the light of what his authority was? Well, they are trying to trap him or trick him, so he turns the tables on them. Either way they answer is going to alienate themselves from some group. If they say John was not a prophet, the people will be mad. If they say John was a prophet from God, then Jesus is going to ask them, "Well, John spoke of me. Why didn't you believe him?" Now, see, it's really very relevant to the issue of authority because John said of Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God." You might want to see John 1:29 where this is touched on. So Jesus is asking a very pertinent question, but they won't answer him, and he won't answer them. Now notice, if you would, where it mentions here. By the way, verses 5 and 6 show us that obviously these men were not concerned with truth. They were concerned with practicality, how to get off the horns of the dilemma with the least problems. That's what they're worried about. Notice it says, "They will stone us." Well, being stoned to death in the Old Testament is one of the punishments for blasphemy. For a prophet who was not of God would be killed. A prophet who was of God, if someone attacked that true prophet, they would be killed. And this is the idea here. "For they are convinced that John was a prophet." And to do that, you might want to see Luke chapter 3, which describes John and his ministry clearly. "So they answered and said, they did not know where it was from. And Jesus said to them, I'm not going to tell you what sort of authority I have for doing as I do." Okay, there's that. Then he went up to tell the people the following story. Now, the parable recorded in verses 9 through 16 is obviously related to the religious leaders unwilling to say what they really believe because of other considerations than simply truth. Now, you must decide this parable is a very hard parable against one of two groups. It seems to me, because it's so similar in its parabolic background to Isaiah 5, that it's the nation of Israel. But verse 19 seems to imply that it may not refer to the whole nation, but simply to the religious leaders. And so you'll have to see which you think it is. I don't know how you fit modern Israel into your scheme of things in the Bible. There are many different opinions. Now, this parable is an agricultural parable about a very common practice in Palestine. But the viciousness of these tenant farmers is really outrageous. Now, notice in verse 13 it says, What shall I do? I will send my dearly loved son. And look down at verse 15. So they drove him out of the vineyard and killed him. Now these two references to me particularly relate this parable to the person of Jesus Christ and what the Jewish leaders are going to do through the Romans to him. The dearly beloved son is a title for Jesus throughout the New Testament. The baptism, the transfiguration. They took him outside the city of Jerusalem to kill him, which seems to be what they're talking about here. In verse 16 it says, we have come to put those tenants to death and to give the vineyard to others. It is obvious because of the strong negative statement in the latter part of verse 16, which is only used here in the Gospels, used by Paul sometimes. They understood what he was saying, and it seems to be that the others were the Gentiles. And they were reacting against that, that the kingdom of God should be taken from the Jewish people, the descendants of Abraham by the flesh, and given to the Gentiles was an unheard of possibility. And yet, that is exactly what happened. Now, in verse 17, and he glanced at them and said, then what does this scripture mean? Now, he's going to quote Psalms 118:22. This is a Hillel psalm, praise psalm, that was used during the Passover season. They were very familiar with this psalm because they would be quoting it very soon in the week of Passover observances. Now, that stone which the builders threw away has now become the cornerstone. I wish we knew exactly what a cornerstone was. We don't. Some think it's the cornerstone that sets the angles for the rest of the building. Some think it's the capstone of the building that holds the whole together. We really don't know, but it's obvious it is one of the central pieces of a building. Okay? Now what Jesus is saying is the builders, the nation of Israel, rejected the key stone, the obvious fulfillment. And of course that is used for the Jewish nation's rejection of Jesus as the Messiah. Everyone who falls upon the stone will be shattered. And this is a very important point to me. I really believe that men don't break God's laws. I believe men break themselves on God's law. It's often been said, does God send men to hell? No. I believe men send themselves to hell by their rebellious, willful unwillingness to follow the light they do have. Now here's the second part. And he on whom it falls will be crushed to dust. Now that sounds very familiar to two passages I'd like for you to look up. Daniel 2, 34 and 35, and Isaiah 8, 14 and 15. Now, both of those deal with this messianic eschatological rock that's going to thwart the enemies of God. And so you ought to see those. Now, in verse 19, another group is going to try to trap Jesus. It does not mention who they are in Luke, but in Matthew 22, 15 and 16, and Mark 12, 13, this is the Pharisees and the Herodians. Now, the Sanhedrin would have been made up of Pharisees and Sadducees, primarily. And now the Pharisees are going to say something to him in cahoots with the Herodians. Now, the Herodians, these two groups would not have been caught in the same room normally. And here they are, ganging up to try to trap Jesus. The Herodians were the follower of the family of Herod, and the Pharisees were the very conservative folks who were very committed to the oral tradition, later codified into the Talmud. Now, notice it mentions here, when the scribes and the high priests had tried to arrest him at that very hour, but they were afraid of the people. Now, they were afraid of two things. They were afraid, number one, that the people would stone them or riot against them. They were also afraid of what the Roman officials or army would do in the face of a riot of any kind. And so, one of those two fears. For they knew that he meant this story for them. Now, there is the verse that says that for sure it's the Jewish leaders, and possibly it's the whole Jewish nation, unbelieving nation. Now, then it continues. So they closely watched and sent spies who pretended to be upright men. Apparently younger men, we would call them theologues, all right, ministerial students. Younger people who they could kind of fake, they really wanted to know this question, they were really concerned with Jesus' answer, but in reality they were not. Now the word spies has the connotation of someone hired to lie in wait for. And the word pretend is a theatrical term for play acting. And so we see they're trying to entrap him. Now, to catch him in a conversation so as to turn him over to the power and authority of the governor or the Romans. They're going to try to capture him or trick him in a particular question that will force him, they think, to say something against the powers that be, Rome. Now, so in verse 21, they say, they ask, "Teacher, Rabbi, we know that you speak the truth, you speak and teach what is right, and show no favor to anyone, but teach the way of God honestly." Well, flattery will set you up every time, but Jesus knew what they were doing. Now, this word, "show no partiality," is the Hebrew idiom, "lift the face." Now, there's two ways to use it. If a judge lifted the face with his hand, he was seeing who it is so he might show favoritism because he recognized the person before him. But this word is used for someone who enters the presence of a judge with his head bowed. And at the kind response of the judge, he lifts his eyes toward the one speaking. And so the metaphor came to mean no partiality. Okay? Let me continue then. Notice what it says, verse 22. Is it right for us? Now, obviously it was right according to Roman law. So the idea here is it right according to God, to the religious law, to your understanding of the law of Moses, is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Now, this was a highly emotional issue. This was the issue that the zealots had chosen to make the central issue in their fight against Rome. Now, the word here in Luke is tribute. But in Matthew and Luke, the word is poll tax. This is exactly the same tax that got Joseph and Mary from Nazareth to Bethlehem. The annual poll tax, the enrollment. Now, what it was on every male from 14 to 65, and it was one denarii a year that went into the emperor's coffers. Now, a denarii is a Roman coin. It's a silver coin, and it was a day's wage. Okay? Now, that's what this poll tax is all about. Now, but he detected their cunning. See Matthew 22:18. And said to them, "Show me a 20-cent coin." Well, that's a bad translation. I don't know what you make in a day, but that'd be what this monetary equivalent is. So he went and got a denarii. Now, a denarii, and you can see the picture of it here. A denarii on one side, this is a Tiberius denarii, had a picture of Tiberius sitting on the throne with the phrase, "Tiberius Caesar Augustus, son of the divine Augustus." And on the back, it had a inscription that said, "Highest Priest." Now, here was a coin that showed that Rome was the governing entity that controlled this area. But on this coin was claims to deity. And so Jesus is going to answer these men in light of their responsibility to government and their responsibility to God. And so what he's going to say is, "Render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and unto God that which is God's." I've been amazed this verse has been used as a proof text to back up the separation of church and state, which in my opinion is not a biblical doctrine, but a developed doctrine of history to somehow back up our capitalistic system. I don't know if that's valid at all. Let me give you a few verses about how the Bible does talk about the Christian's relationship to government. John 19:10-11, Romans 13:1-7, 1 Timothy 2:1-4, Titus 3:1, and 1 Peter 2:13-17. We are to honor government authority, for all authority is from God. So we should pay the taxes. Now, the other side of the question is, if the governmental authority claims divine status or divine prerogative or tries to enter into our life in areas that we feel compelled on grounds of faith toward God, we cannot render unto Caesar those kind of things. This is the place where Augustine built his concept of the two kingdoms, the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of men. And they are coexistent right now, but one day they will not be. We live in two worlds. We are citizens of heaven. We are citizens of a national entity. We have responsibilities toward both, okay? And we must know where we feel we draw the line. Now, whose picture and title does it bear? And they answered, Caesar's. And he said to them, then pay to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and God what belongs to God. In verse 26, so they could not use what he said before the people, and in astonishment at his answer, they said no more. Well, I want you to write down in your Bible, Luke, CF 23:2. For these same people are going to lie about what Jesus said and say that he attacked Rome. later on. But right now, they're awestruck by what he said, and they leave him alone. Now, notice in verse 27, it begins another round of questioning, but with a new group. We've had the Sanhedrin, we've had the Pharisees and the Herodians, and now we have the Sadducees. Now, the Sadducees were the aristocratic, wealthy group that controlled the high priesthood. They were in cahoots with Rome. They wanted the status quo maintained because they were in the place of wealth and power. They also seemed to reject the oral tradition that the Pharisees were so excited about, and that's what Josephus tells us. They also seemed to deny the afterlife. Now, we get that from Acts 23:8, and the writings of Flavius Josephus, the Jewish War, 2:8-14, and the Antiquities of the Jews, 18:1-4. And so it was a unique political and religious group. Now, let me continue. And they go into a deal about Moses wrote for us a law. Now, what law are they talking about? Well, if you'll write down Deuteronomy 25:5 and following and go read that, it's called the Levirate marriage law. Now, remember that lever is a Latin word for brother-in-law. We are not talking about the Levites of the tribe of Levi who made up the priesthood. We're not talking about that. We are talking about lever or brother-in-law. And if you'll read Deuteronomy 25:5 and following, you'll see that it's based on the problem of inheritance, keeping inheritance within families and tribes. And you might want to see Numbers 27:6-11. The reason adultery was such a horrendous sin in ancient Israel is because it fouled up the inheritance. And that's when it was so serious. Now, this was a trick question because the Sadducees did not believe in an afterlife. And therefore, they are trying to show Jesus to be foolish in his understanding of the afterlife. So what they're going to do is, suppose there was a man who was married and his wife didn't have any children. And there were seven brothers and all of them died and all of them married this woman. Who would this woman be married to in heaven? I am so glad that Jesus answered this question because it gives us a little insight onto our position in the afterlife. And here's what he said. Jesus said, "The people of this world marry and are married. But those who are considered worthy to attain that other world and the resurrection of the dead neither marry nor are not married." So what he's saying is, in heaven there is no marriage. Now, that's hard for me to believe. I am happily married. I can't imagine not being with my wife, and especially after we have lived many years and died. I don't think it's going to be less joy. I think it's going to be greater joy. And what that basically means is that as we come together, a man, a woman, in such great joy, that fellowship is going to be even more when we get to heaven. Now, I know that's hard to believe, but I think that's what it's talking. It's not that we're going to have less, it's that we're going to have more. Now, it continues then when it says, "And they cannot die again. They are like the angels." Now, some say that means the angels are sexless. I do not believe this is primarily talking about the angels' sexlessness. I believe the angels do have sexual potential, which I get from Genesis chapter 6. I've done a tape called Angels Marrying Women, and you might want to send for that. I think those are the angels that are kept in Tartarus, in the chains. They're not loose. But I do think that that's valid there. So this is primarily, in context, a focus on the immortality of angels, okay? And it will be the children of God. "But that the dead are raised, even Moses at the bush has demonstrated when he calls the Lord the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." Now, this is in that beautiful passage in Exodus chapter 3 that deals with the covenant name for God, Yahweh. And in that, he says that he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the interpretation here is that they're not dead and gone. They are still alive and with God, and that's the implication here. And it's from Exodus 3:6, that chapter. "He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. People are all alive to him." Now, I do not believe in the Greek concept of the immortality of the soul, but I certainly believe in the concept that once we are created, because of the way God has dealt with us, that we are going to live forever once we are created. I do not believe we have a pre-existence, but I believe that once we're created, we will always have a conscious existence beyond that. Now, the real question of the Bible, is it going to be a conscious existence with God and in fellowship with God, or is it going to be a conscious existence separated from God? Now, if you look at Matthew 25:46, the same word eternal that's used for eternal life is the same word eternal that's used for eternal damnation. And the Bible that teaches us God is love and presents the gospel is the same Bible that presents God is wrath when his love is spurned and there is an ultimate price of separation to pay. So, verse 39. Then some of the scribes answered him. Notice what they're going to say. Teacher, you have given a fine answer. Obviously, most of the scribes, which are the religious lawyers, they took over the role of the Levites in teaching the law. And so they're the lawyers that apply the law of Moses and the oral tradition to everyday life. Most of them, we know, were Pharisees. And so therefore, that's the answer here. That they're pleased because Jesus put the bite on the Sadducees, who were their theological opponents, right? Now, I wish that they would have seen more light, but we don't know what they did. For they did not dare to ask him any more questions. Well, all three groups batted zero, struck out, and they're going to leave him alone now. But in the midst of this, Jesus is still in the temple area, and I think Jesus was trying as hard as he could to win the religious leaders. I think he was sincerely trying to get them to think and to bring them to himself. Now, this is what he's going to say. Then he said to them, these religious groups, how do people say that the Christ, now this is the Messiah, the word Christ is the Greek equivalent of the Hebrew word Messiah, which means the anointed one, which means someone specially equipped and called, which came to be ultimate, the person who was going to break into history by God and set up the new age. The Christ is David's son. Now being David's son, they were expecting him to have the characteristics of David. David, as you know, was a military man. He was not able to build a temple because he had so much blood on his hands. They were expecting David's son to be a military man, to overthrow the Romans, to set up the Jewish nation as the epitome of all nations, and bring the Gentiles into Jerusalem. And there is a sense in which he is a military man. When we see him again, oh Lord, he is going to be on the white charger. He is going to be Lord of Lords, King of Kings. But friends, when he came the first time, he came as the suffering servant of Isaiah. Now, so they're going to ask him. For David himself said in the book of Psalms. Now, we're in Psalms 110:1. There are several passages that tell us that he's of divinic descent. 2 Samuel 7, Isaiah 11, Matthew 1:1, Romans 1:3. The Messiah will be of divinic descent. Now, so David calls him Lord. How then can he be his son? Now, that's after we quote Psalms 110:1. Now, I want you to turn quickly in your Old Testaments to Psalms 110:1. And I want you to look at your English translation. Do you see the first word, Lord? Do you notice in all caps, the O is capitalized, the R is capitalized, the D is capitalized? Now look at the second word for Lord. The L is capitalized, but the rest are small. Now, most English translations keep that distinction. The first word is Yahweh, YHWH, the covenant name for God from that Exodus 3 passage. The second one is Adonai, which they inserted because they were afraid to pronounce the covenant name for God, lest they take it in vain. Now, here we have both names right together, okay? So David calls him Lord. How can then be his son? And that's he's trying to deal with this rabbinical understanding of who David's son is and who the Messiah is. Kind of hard for us to follow today, but the Jews understood completely what he was saying. While all the people were listening, he said to the disciples, beware of the scribes who like to go about in long robes and love to be saluted with honor in public places, be seated in the front seats of the synagogue, and occupy the places of honor at the banquets. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I think this is a real word of caution to those of us who are leaders in the church. These scribes were acting out of sincere motives, out of what they believed to be correct theology. But they were pompous and arrogant and self-righteous. And they tended not only to try for the best places, but they did things that ate up widows' houses and covered up with long prayers. I think we need to be real careful that just because we wear the ecclesiastical accoutrements of leadership, that our hearts are right and open and contrite and reverent and repentant toward God, lest the leaders in the church fall into the same condemnation as the leaders of Israel. It's easy to do. Those who work at the altar become unfortunately accustomed to their work. Now, they will receive a much heavier sentence. That's the last part of verse 47, the end of this chapter. I personally believe in degrees of both heaven and hell. I believe heaven, if we have yielded ourselves to God's Spirit, if we have availed ourselves of our spiritual gift, if we are growing in Christ, that we're going to have a greater capacity to appreciate fellowship with God. I also believe that as we have rejected the light that we have, if we have not had much light, those who've never heard, or if we've rejected in the presence of great light the unpardonable sin, that our punishment will be based on how much light we have had and how we've responded to it. Let me give you a few other passages I think talk about degrees of punishment. Matthew 11, verses 22 and 24, Luke 12, verses 47 and 48, along with this verse here, seem to imply degrees of punishment, and I think rewards describes degrees of heaven. I think if we're in heaven, we're going to be filled up. Some may have bigger containers. I think we're going to not know someone else is getting more and we're getting less. We're going to be maximized, actualized to the fullest potential we have. In hell, I think that those who have never had the opportunity others had will be in a much better condition, though they'll still be in hell. And I can't explain all that. I'd rather be in the lowest part of heaven than the highest part of hell. There's a great gap there, but I still think there are degrees. Well, I've enjoyed being with you. I hope you'll go back through and outline this along the lines of the three groups and why they would attack him. And we have just a little picture here of some of Jesus' teaching during these last days of his life. I've enjoyed being with you.